The gold standard is not a fixed. The gold standard is not a fixed exchange rate system, because all nations on the gold standard use the same currency. They use the same commodity as money. What about paper currency? Banknotes and government-issued notes under the gold standard were not money proper, but as I said, they were money substitutes. And they substituted for gold in exchange as warehouse receipts. So you were trading claims to gold. You didn't need to trade the physical gold. It gave you greater security. It was more convenient to carry around claims to gold. It was simply a title that expressed the fact that you were the owner of the underlying asset or thing that was referred to. So let's look at some of these money substitutes. Prior to 1920, banks could not only issue checking deposits, but private commercial banks could also issue their own notes. So let's take one from the Farmers and Merchants National Bank of Los Angeles. Notice what it says. It will pay to the bearer on demand $20. The $20 is that gold ounce that will be paid to you if you bring in for redemption that piece of paper. So people recognized it as what it was, and it was clear what it was. But what was written on the face of the note, that it was a claim to gold. So let's talk about the connection between the gold standard and money and prices. So when in redeeming $20 for a gold ounce, they were not, as the monetarists claim, selling gold. They weren't selling gold to you. They were just fulfilling their contractual obligation of redeeming that claim to gold. There was no sale involved here, because you can't sell a claim against what it's claiming. That's just a legal interaction. So in the long run, under a genuine gold standard, the money supply is strictly limited by gold mining, or as we'll see, more strictly by the balance of payments. Countries that don't mine gold. You can only increase banknotes and bank deposits to the extent that gold flows into the banks. There is some wiggle room there. They can change their reserve ratio. But for the most part, the money supply increases and contracts with flows of gold. And this is rational. This is embedded in subjective decisions that drive the trade of goods and services. So the result was that since we had tremendous economic growth, let's say in the U.S., after the Civil War, we went from basically an agrarian nation before the Civil War to the mightiest industrial nation in the world by World War I. There was a tremendous amount of technological improvement, of saving and investment, and the accumulation of new capital and so on, and that caused the supplies of goods and services to increase year after year. The money supply under the gold standard increased extremely slowly, much slower than was the increase in the supply of goods and services, so therefore the natural effect was for prices to fall. And I call this growth deflation that results from growth. You know, we were told back in the 1960s and 70s, when Keynesian economics was riding high, that inflation was always accompanied growth. Growth was inflationary. That's ridiculous. Economists have always recognized that economic growth is, all other things equal, deflationary. But mainstream economists are beginning to recognize that today, and that's not a bad thing. One thing I want to point out is that there's a natural market mechanism to keep prices from falling too much in some sense, even under growth deflation. You don't see it here, but prices began to rise right around the late 1890s, and they rose all the way up until 1913. That was a natural phenomenon because it resulted from the gold, new discoveries in sources of gold, and also new discoveries in how to extract gold from ore. So we had an increase in gold production from year to year over those years, and that drove prices up again. But that wasn't all simply an accident where we found new sources of gold and so on. When you have a fall in prices, all prices fall, including the capital goods that are used in mining, extracting, and exploring for gold. So gold becomes more valuable. As general prices fall, the value of gold goes up, obviously, because it's the other side of the coin. And as a result, that lowers the cost of producing gold, exploring for gold, increases the profitability of gold mining.
The integration of various levels of inquiry, the other, the question of the integration of cognitive systems, various levels of integration of various levels of inquiry, the other, the question of the integration of cognitive systems, the first question we expect, just their scientific faith in the unity of nature or something. We expect that there's going to be an answer to the first question, whether we can find it or not, but there's no particular reason to expect an answer to the second. There may be or there may not be. If there isn't, there's no unified cognitive science. For the moment, there's real progress in a few areas, including vision at the computational representational level, and in this case also at the cellular level. There's progress in language, but almost solely at the computational representational level, and some performance things like acquisition. There's studies of conceptual development, closely related to language, quite interesting. There's studies of probabilistic reasoning and error and various other topics. There are all sorts of areas where there's interesting results concerning human cognitive function. As far as I'm aware, all within the framework of highly modular assumptions, which, as I said, seem to be natural. But we're very far from any understanding of the articulation, the architecture, the general structure of the mind-brain, apart from a very few specific modules which appear to have their own special design. That leaves most of the questions one might like to ask enshrouded in mystery, and it's entirely possible that this is mystery of a kind that a human intelligence, which after all has its own specific biological properties, is unable to penetrate, even in principle.
One thing that struck me was that the statement a child acquires language rapidly is interest relative in exactly the same fashion that the statement Boston is near to New York. How do you answer some mind-brain functionalist who comes to you and says, the child acquires language excruciatingly slowly. We have this huge neural net. There are billions of synapse firings and billions of weight changes. If it is genuinely interest relative and the child acquires language rapidly is only a true statement within some shared interest, how do you establish between yourself and this mind-brain person a shared interest that establishes your statement is true?
That's a very good point. In fact, when I say that language is acquired very rapidly, you're absolutely right. That's like John's almost home, what's rapidly. That's only meant to stimulate your imagination. It's not meant as a proposal. The way to answer the question is to construct an explicit proposal as to how the language is acquired. Now, there are specific proposals based on innate structure. Kind of what I was saying before, if somebody can propose a general learning mechanism or some kind of a network or something that does anything, then we'll have something to talk about. So far, the only thing we have is highly specific structures.
The idea that we seem to be directing our energy studying things that people don't do very well, that seems to point to something on even a mundane level for me. I get the feeling that a lot of the what might be called infrastructural problems of society today are, when it comes down to it, moral problems. What we treat as economics problems and these sorts of things. And I believe that that will have to do with people concentrating on things that humans do well. And when I think about it, I think that a lot of the things that people do well are very simple, subtle things that people also take for granted. And that most of the people in this world seem to be running around trying to impress each other by doing things better that people don't do very well. I just wonder what you thought about this kind of thinking.
I'm not sure I understand the implications of what you're saying. I agree with particular statements. We ought to be studying the things that people do well if we want to understand people. I also agree that the problems of society are in substantial part moral problems, but only in the sense that when we plan our actions, we try to change things or whatever, we're doing it in terms of some kind of moral values. We ought to be as clear about that as we can. Some conception of what's right for people and so on. And it's good to be clear about that. But beyond that, I don't know where to go. I think these subjects are too intellectually thin for deep analysis to carry us very far. You work pretty much by instinct and intuition.
Say Italy today or Germany today. I mean, the differences among the things that we call German are enormous, so enormous as to lead to non-mutual intelligibility. You have to learn the national language when you go to school. It's a different language than the one you spoke at home. What happens is that between generations, there are usually small changes having to do with other influences from the outside and so on. And these things are cumulative. Sometimes they lead to pretty dramatic changes. When we talk about language change, that's very misleading. You know, it's like predicting the weather. here. There's just too many things going on. Human life is a pretty complicated affair.
The closer I get to the border between France and Germany, would the closer the languages become?
Well, first of all, you're assuming the French is different from German. If you go from, say, Paris to Rome, as you go toward the Italian border, it starts to sound more like Italian, and at some point it becomes Italian. By now, there's enough national unity and so on so you can really find a border. But if you go back a little ways, there was no border. There was just I wouldn't say a continuum, there's just constant changes and fluctuations and variations, and you started speaking one thing in one place and another thing in another place, and they're not mutually intelligible often, but along the way there are just all sorts of changes. In France, this position is kind of extreme. In fact, if you go back to its origins, it's even a little bit comical. I don't know if anybody's actually studied it, but if you go back to, say, the 18th century and you read, say, Diderot, he says France is going to be the language of science, and German and English will be the language of literature. And the reason for this is that French is very clear. In France, the words follow the order of the thoughts, whereas if you listen to German and English, the words don't quite follow the words of the thought. So French is good for telling the truth because of its, what later came to be called, its Gallic lucidity and clarity, whereas the German and English, maybe Italian, they're good languages for telling fantasies and falsehoods, so they'll be the languages of literature. Now, it's a sort of naive point of view, but you can see what was going on in his head. I mean, for him, the words in French follow the order of thoughts. When you hear German, it seems all confused. And I suspect that the mythology of the purity and lucidity and clarity of French goes back to ideas of that kind. After all, French culture had a certain dominance and appeal for a long time, so these attitudes get established. And some of them may have prestige associated with them. For example, some of them may be the speech of a conquering group or a wealthy group or a priestly caste or one thing or another, and we may decide, okay, those are the good ones and some other ones the bad one. But if social and political relations reversed, we'd make the opposite conclusions.
But that raises an interesting question. Why does language have rules? Why were we taught these rules in grade school?
Well, when you're taught rules of your own language in grade school, the chances are very strong that what you're being taught is false. Otherwise, you wouldn't have to be taught it.
I can see every grade school teacher about to throw an orange at you on the screen.
Well, let me be a little more nuanced. One of the things you learn in grade school is the literary language. Now, in English, the literary standard is not so radically different from what, say, you and I grew up with, but it's somewhat different. The literary standard is not what I learned in the streets. And when I went to school, I was taught the literary standard. Now, the literary standard has some principles associated with it, some of which are those of a real language, some of which are completely artificial. They were made up by people who had crazy ideas about language. The reason you have to teach them is because they are not the person's language. Your actual language, nobody teaches it. You don't learn it any more than you learn to see. Now, the fact is that the system that grows in the brain is sometimes different from a system which is regarded, for whatever reason, as necessary or appropriate or something, some prestige dialect. And it may be different from what grew in your brain. It typically is. So what we call good English is a system which is partly artificial, I should say, which is taught to people because it was legislated to be good English. And you ask the question, why do you have to teach people? Well, you have to teach them because it's artificial. It's not their language.